Let's talk about some of the political points surrounding global warming. Now, I've presented data to you that shows that the climate models get all their main predictions wrong, that therefore CO2 is not the main cause of the recent global warming. That data was impeccably sourced from the very best sources. It's very relevant. It's publicly available. Anyone can download it. And it's from our very best instruments. So how come it's never ever appeared in the mainstream media? If the mainstream media were interested in the truth, they would seek out the best and latest data, and they would check it against the predictions. But they don't. The media don't appear to be curious. Not as if global warming hasn't been a big issue for several years now. Yet somehow, all the world's investigative journalists fail to notice that the climate models get all their main predictions wrong. Really? Even though we point it out to them? It's not that complicated. We all understand temperature. The climate model said it would do this and the atmosphere would heat like that, but it didn't. Just download the data yourself and check. So, the data is being suppressed. So this argument is not about science and truth. So it must be about power and politics instead. Reluctantly, uncomfortably, the only possible conclusion you can come to is that the media don't want to investigate the claims of the government climate scientists. Why? Who benefits? To try to get an answer to that, let's look at the array of forces involved in this argument. Let's look at the alarmists. There you have the United Nations with the IPCC, you have Western governments, you have major banks and financials, the NGOs and the greenies, the totalitarian leftists, government-funded scientists, nearly all of academia, the corporations that produce renewables, and the mainstream media. On the skeptic side, you've just got the private sector, middle-class type people, you've got independently funded scientists, and you've got amateurs. Now, the supporters of climate alarmism are all either financial beneficiaries, or they're believers in bigger government, or they're greenies, or multiple. Overwhelmingly, they're university educated. Overwhelmingly, they prefer the methods of government, that's politics and coercion, to set their rewards, rather than the marketplace, methods of the marketplace of voluntary transactions. They prefer politics and coercion. They're an intellectual upper class of word users. They like to regulate and pontificate, rather than produce real stuff. Probably not going too far to say they're a class of parasites enriching themselves at the expense of producers. So why is this issue of climate change so very, very important to them? Well, the solution they're offering is to regulate CO2 emissions. They want to regulate CO2 emissions, which would mean they control all energy use right throughout an economy, and they want to regulate every economy in the world. Let's talk about the Copenhagen Treaty in 2009. Because something very important happened that most of the world doesn't realise it yet. The Copenhagen Treaty was an international treaty, and all the leaders of the world went to Copenhagen in Denmark in 2009, late in 2009, to sign this treaty. Now, China refused, citing problems with the science, not being sure that carbon dioxide was in fact responsible for global warming. And other nations followed suit, and no treaty was signed. A Copenhagen Accord was signed, but that was a much lesser thing. Now, you can still find the Copenhagen Treaty on some corners of the internet, and you can download it. It's 181 pages of fairly dense bureaucratic language, and it's a draft, but it's clear enough in intent. If you do look at it, look on page 18 at clauses 36 and 38, for instance. This treaty would have set up a UN bureaucracy that would have regulated CO2 worldwide, as you'd expect. That treaty meant that they could override any national market or any national government as required. Furthermore, any signatory government could be taxed or fined by this global bureaucracy. Now, I put it to you that due to the normal methods of centralisation of power, over about 20 or 30 years, that would have been parlayed up into a strong global bureaucracy that would be doing a little bit more than just regulating CO2 emissions. Yet the media were almost entirely silent about the treaty and about the implied loss of national sovereignty, normally the media gets very, very worked up and very noisy about elections or wars or anything else that changes government. About this treaty, nothing, almost complete silence. This was a narrowly averted silent coup by this new regulating class. Climate science, so-called, is clearly flawed, but it's just an excuse. A global bureaucracy is a pretty bad idea if you think about it. It means that you've got nowhere to run to from high taxes, from persecution or exploitation. It means the end of competition that between countries, between sovereigns. It keeps them in check, it treats them, makes them treat their productive citizens decently. You see, for millennia, if a kingdom or a country treated its productive citizens poorly, we could leave to another country. If there's a global bureaucracy running the show, we can't leave. A global bureaucracy, one global regime, is very prone to tyranny taking over forever, because there's no longer an outside, there's no longer a place to get refuge or help from. Here's what's at stake for you. Basically, unless you're part of the regulating class, what's at stake for you is freedom from the demands of a hostile ruling class. You see, this new regulating class of bureaucrats and academics and greenies and the like, they really don't like the rest of us. They don't like people not like them. And they especially don't like people in the private sector, and they especially don't like people who make real stuff. Imagine a world where this new regulating class regulate and tax everyone, everywhere in the world. The traditional strategy of moving to a friendlier country would be lost forever. The status and conditions of workers everywhere would fall permanently. We'd be back to being serfs. National democracies would be powerless because the global bureaucracy would make the rules. And you couldn't vote them out. Now, skeptics saved the world. That's a big claim, but there's a germ of truth to it. The skeptics distributed enough data showing that climate alarmism is greatly exaggerated. We've got just enough out there, just in time, so that by the 2009 Copenhagen Treaty, it almost got signed. Those leaders went to Copenhagen expecting to sign the treaty, but in the end they didn't. The threat of a bureaucratic coup using climate change as an excuse is receding, as more people find out that the whole idea of the climate science is somewhat exaggerated. But the threat is still present. Let's talk a little bit about the tactics of this new regulating class, because they're worth examining. If you oppose this new class, here's what they'll do. Now, automatically, they'll call you names. They'll call you an extremist, they'll call you right-wing, they'll call you a nut, they'll call you a conspiracy theorist, they'll call you every version of stupid and ignorant. And they'll do it in the newspapers and the current affairs and the TV shows and websites and movies, everywhere, because they own all that stuff. That scares most people into submission. Oh, I don't want to say anything, they might call me names. It also has the effect of making them extremely arrogant and confident to the point of delusion, because they really think we are ignorant kooks. But remember, above all, they want to shut us up by any means short of physical violence. Another tactic. Oh, this is a pair of witch doctors. See this picture here? A couple of witch doctors. Witch doctors have a long role in human history. Witch doctors would say, oh, the gods are angry. But we know how to appease them. But it'll cost you a great deal of money. There are other tactics. They say, trust us. We are the experts. All the experts agree with us. Or the flip side, they'll say, anyone who disagrees with us is a fool, or a nut, or just politically motivated. You heard that before? They never debate. They simply denigrate opponents. Why debate? Have an honest debate. When you own the media, you don't have to. If you get cornered, just bluff, make it up. The media will never question you, and the public will never figure it out. Yet, the skeptics are winning. How? First thing, the internet. We know we're winning because the Western public was about 20% skeptical according to opinion polls in about 2008. Now it's about 50% skeptical. The message is here that the internet trumps the mainstream media. It just takes a while. The suppressed data does get through. Now, there's an historical precedent for this. In Europe, before 1400, the church had a monopoly on distributing high-quality information from the pulpit. Then, the printing press was invented. Soon afterwards, you had the Reformation, and eventually the Enlightenment, and the power and status of the church went down considerably. For the last 50 years or more, the mainstream media has had a lock on information distribution in the West, but that monopoly is being shattered now by the internet. Another way we know we're winning is through legislation. Governments are backing off regulating carbon dioxide emissions. Only Europe, Australia and New Zealand have done anything serious about it, and of those, only Australia has done anything that's punitive or really effective, and that's only because the Greens, by an electoral fluke, hold the balance of power. How do we get the legislators on our side? We got the suppressed data through to them in lobbyists' briefcases. For example, the United States Congress was all hot to do something about climate change. In 2009, they just elected Obama, elected a new Democrat Senate and House. The lobbyists went in, they showed them the data, and in enough cases, the legislators looked at it and said, well, we're not going to do anything about regulating CO2, and they made it known. Now everyone knows that the US Congress is not going to do anything to regulate CO2. And the same is true of many other parliaments around the world. Finally, the good news is the planet will be okay. The climate models exaggerate greatly. There will be some mild warming due to our CO2, but in the tropics it'll have no effect, and elsewhere it'll just be equivalent to moving a few kilometres closer to the tropics. And finally, CO2 is good for the plants. You want to read some more? I've written a paper about this. It's quite simple to understand, very readable. It's at sciencespeak.com. And it's called Climate Coup to Politics. Thank you.